Retro.
Hello there. This is James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continuously unexpected. So uncivilized.
This is podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, this is Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to Podcast Stardust, the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. We'll be discussing this week's news in this episode. Before we do, Jay can remind everybody where they can follow us on social media.
It'd be my pleasure, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
So this is episode 250 of Podcast Stardust. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for all your support over the past year and a half. Jay, I can't believe we've made it. 250 episodes, a quarter millennial club at this point.
Yes, I'm throwing virtual confetti right now because it's so exciting. And we've just been having so much fun and our listenership has been growing so much. And thank you to all of you that are listening right now. And it's been amazing. So it's such a gift to be able to keep doing this. And hopefully we get to do it for another 250 more and then some. Put another zero, 2,500. Let's go for it.
Okay. Ambition. So I'm putting you on the spot here, but do you have a favorite episode from these past 250 or 249 part of the night?
I absolutely love all of our deep dives into the Rogue One series, the Empire Strikes Back series. You know, there's probably not necessarily just one that stands out to me. And of course, our guests such as Vanessa Marshall and Lauren Mary Kim. And we've been so blessed. We really have. And everything has just been so much fun. I honestly can't pick one, but do you have one?
You just ticked off all the boxes that I was going to, to mention there as well. No, I'm with you. We've had a lot of fun discussions over the past year and a half. And of course, when we started this, Resistance was still going on. And then we got into the first season Mandalorian. So I loved recapping all the Mandalorian episodes from that first season, and then the Empire Strikes Back series was just so much fun getting to talk to everybody and doing our deep dives, as you said, 10 minutes at a time into that movie was just fantastic, really getting into the nitty-gritty. And then we've continued that this year with Rogue One, doing the seventh season of the Clone Wars, especially since we had no idea that was even coming.
Right.
So that's been fantastic. And the High Republic, getting to explore this whole new era of Star Wars with you on the podcast has just been an absolute blast. So a lot of great things have just happened over the past year and a half. We're talking about 1.5 years. And
yes,
we've had so much Star Wars and there is so much more, even more on the horizon. So
absolutely,
we're, as you say, we're very blessed here with Star Wars. But
we are indeed.
I know people don't tune in to hear us talk about ourselves, so we'll get into the news. And with that,
why don't they? Come on, we should do some more of that. No.
The dish is aligned, the signal is boosted to maximum output, the shield is down, and we are now broadcasting the galaxy. So let's get into this week's Star Wars news. Up first, Jay, I thought you were going to be very excited about this story, but Matt Lanter is hinting that there is more of his Anakin to come. And this came during an interview with EW.com. He shared that he is, during an interview for Jupiter's Legacy, which is coming on Netflix, that he has been quietly working on some projects for Lucasfilm Animation after Clone Wars concluded with its series finale last year. And he went on to say that there's some new Lucasfilm animation going on. I've been a part of some things I can't quite talk about yet. You'll see Anakin again, Lanter promises. I never quite put Anakin down, whether I'm doing a video game or something new for Lucasfilm Animation. So what do you make of that?
Well, I don't know why you would possibly think I'd be excited about Anakin. I mean, come on. But no, this is super duper exciting, of course. And I'm surprised that he's giving anything away, you know, even being able to say new Lucasfilm Animation. But I guess that's really not that big a surprise because we know there's a lot of animation on the horizon. But getting to see Anakin again in Clone Wars animation style and getting to hear Matt Lanter's voice doing it. Oh, yeah, that's awesome. And I do have to say, too, I've been following him on Instagram and all of the Jupiter's Legacy things. And that looks really cool. I'm going to have to tune into that, too. So, but yes, always Anakin all the time is good in my book.
Jupiter's Legacy is something that I'm not current on, but I'll have to check that out. But I've been trying to figure out, is he talking about something with the Bad Batch? Which seems unlikely because Anakin's now Darth Vader at this point. So what are we talking about? Is it one-off episodes for the Clone Wars? It's just something completely different. I'm trying to pinch it. Of course, there's new video games coming out all the time, and he could be doing the voice for Anakin in a Lego Star Wars game. Mm-hmm. You know, something as simple as that. But he specifically mentions Lucasfilm Animation, which is something different than Lucasfilm Games. So they went out of their way to tell us that recently. So I'm excited by that. I hope he has not misspoke and that there is actually something coming up with more animated Anakin. I would just dig that. That'd be awesome.
Oh, definitely. And I almost wonder if there might be, you know, like the last missions of the Clone Wars. That would be really kind of cool. But yeah, you're absolutely right with the distinction between Lucasfilm Animation and LucasArts with the Lucasfilm video game kinds of things. So once again, we'll just have to wait and see. And again, this is another thing I love about doing this podcast, and just have to take a quick aside, is that we get to have fun with all the hype, you know, getting to, it's almost like wondering what you're going to open on Christmas morning or on your birthday, you know, or whatever holiday. It's just, love it.
Agreed. Absolutely. I just love imagining what the possibilities might be. Mm-hmm. All right, so some other television news. We have another cast member joining the Obi-Wan Kenobi series, and this time it is Maya Erskine. And this has been reported by Deadline, and I think subsequently backed up by Variety. Her previous work includes Pen 15, The Insecure, and Scoob. I don't really know much about Maya Erskine, but how about you? Is she someone you're familiar with, or what do you think?
No, actually not at all. And I went into her IMDb page just to try to do a little bit of digging on her as well. And she's definitely a fresh face in my book. So I'm really intrigued to see where she fits into the puzzle.
Yeah, I know Pen 15 was nominated for some Emmys. And so she got some acclaim there. But it'll be interesting to see what she brings to Obi-Wan Kenobi. And I'm looking forward to that. And sometimes it's kind of nice not knowing a whole lot about all these actors and everything that comes with them so that we aren't automatically assuming a role for them. So we'll see what happens with Maya going forward.
Definitely.
Well, let's talk about some book news. First up, we have an exclusive excerpt from The Rising Storm over on StarWars.com. Of course, this is the next adult novel by Kevin Scott in the High Republic series, and it's arriving on June 29th. And we were just talking quite a bit about Ty Yorick last week in our news episode, and we get a little bit more details here. Did you get a chance to read the excerpt?
Yes, I did. And for me, of course, Kevin Scott always knocks it out of the park, but this kind of has some shades of Dr. Aphra for me. You know, mm-hmm. I almost get that vibe about her that she's, you know, not like a loose cannon kind of a character, although she's kind of been portrayed that way. But it seems like it's really going to be a fun read from that type of writing that he's giving us in this.
Yeah, I got a little bit of that and a little bit of the Mandalorian vibe on this one. And mm-hmm. the reason being is that because this excerpt has Ty Yorick showing up on this planet of Safrifa, where she rescues a child from a local marsh lord rival of whoever the child belonged to. And then as she's preparing to go, some villagers show up with a little bit of money and say, hey, we need your help. Can you defeat this monster that's killing our children? And it reminded mm-hmm. me of the fourth episode from season one of The Mandalorian, when the Mandalorian shows up on, I can't even think of the name of the planet where they
met Omera Sanctuary.
Yeah, mm-hmm. exactly. And he's not really looking to do anything, but then these villagers show up because they need some help dealing with some raiders, and they've got mm-hmm. a little bit of money. And it's the whole idea that he can get away from something. So again, her conscience kind of tugs at her here with this. And so she's got that mercenary vibe going on as well, and she's already done the job she's been paid for. It seemed pretty cool. Plus, I found it fascinating. She has a YT-750 mm-hmm. freighter an earlier version of Han Solo's YT-1300. That's pretty cool.
I caught on that right away. I was like, ooh, Carillion make. Okay, we're going to have to take a look at this one a little bit more. But yeah, I love how you pointed that out with the Mandalorian. I think you're absolutely right with that too. And I did pick up there was a lot of references to different types of roots and species, and even the planet itself and the people that lived on the planet. And I thought to myself, wow, someone that doesn't really know a lot about Star Wars is either going to get a heck of a lot of education about this kind of stuff, or they're just going to fall into it and say, oh, this must be a lot like this. Which, you know, I kind of tried to take myself out of universe for a second while I was reading the excerpt, but I was sucked right in. I mean, just with, there was a lot of new stuff, even just in that small little thing that we got.
Right. And when you think of Kevin Scott and his work on Star Wars, it's been the High Republic Adventures. It's been these audio dramas.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been the Marvel comics that he's done lately. So, adult novel is new ground for him when it comes to Star Wars. And I think it sounded fantastic. It was a very short excerpt. It did not give a ton away, barely any of the plot there. You can read it without really being spoiled about anything. And it sounded great. I'm really excited for this.
Me too. And I have to admit, sometimes when I read through some of these excerpts, I just kind of skim through them. Mm-hmm. But I actually found myself really pausing and trying to drink this one in. So yeah, this makes me even more excited for this book.
Definitely. The other note of the other thing that's worth taking note of is that when she's asked about her ship's name, it doesn't have one. Mm-hmm. She just goes by, it kind of reminds me of the vessel from Audie Gray's book. But then she makes note of not even forming attachments to objects because they can't love you back. And so that extends to her lightsaber, her droids. We talked about the droids that she has, the protocol droid and the astromech droid. Apparently she didn't give them names either.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a different take on attachment there. It sounds like it's that she's not unwilling to form attachments. She's not just not willing to form an attachment to anything that's not capable of reciprocating.
Yes. She sounds like she's going to be a really fun character to dive into.
Right. All right. Well, I can't wait for that one, but we do have a new Star Wars book out as of today, the 27th when we're recording this. And that is the latest entry in the Thrawn Ascendancy series, The Greater Good. I got my copy, but you know, behind the curtains here, I'm a huge NFL draft geek. And unless anything that's put in front of me has the words draft with the first pick, has the ESPN chimes or whatever, I just haven't been paying too much attention. So I haven't got into it yet. But have you had a chance to crack your copy yet, Jay?
Well, I've cracked the audiobook, let's put it that way. And by cracking it, I do mean exactly that. I listened to maybe the first 5 minutes. So I'm actually feeling pretty good about myself that I think this is the first time I'm actually ahead of you on one of the book releases. But you have a very good excuse. But yes, I listened to the introduction and, like I said, the very first 5 minutes, and it's just so excited because it's bringing us right back to where we kind of left off for the most part. So
yeah, I know there's another exclusive excerpt out there that you can read, and I just haven't bothered since the book is out now. And I did listen to a previous excerpt, and it sounds like the last book, which is fantastic, which we really enjoyed last year. I know it was one of our favorite books of the year. So I'm looking forward to getting into that one. And next week, I'll really be diving in with both feet and checking it out. And I can't wait for that. But also, when it comes to The Greater Good, just like the first book in the series, it's getting a collector's edition that'll be coming out on August 10th, 2021. It has an exclusive jacket cover, which is going to be designed by Magali Villanueva. It has a special foil stamped slipcase signed by Timothy Zahn, or the book is that way. Anyways, it has true stained book pages in vibrant red. I'm not sure exactly what that means. The pages also have blue accents and features, and this collector's edition is limited to 750 copies and 3 books per order. It's cool. I know some Thrawn enthusiasts that are going to love this and will snap it right up. I'm not one of them. As much as I love Thrawn and these books, it will be I'll content myself with the standard edition that comes out. But what do you think about this one, Jay?
Okay, this one I'm a total sucker for. I have to admit, this is absolutely glorious. I love the uniform that he's wearing. It's this black leather with these gold medallions, and I'm assuming that they have to do with the nine ruling families or his family. You know, all of that. I just think it's absolutely wonderful. And I tried to actually look up what a true stained book means, and all I could find was how to get stains out of books. Like if you get coffee stains on your books, like what do you do to get it out? So if anybody out there in podcast artist land knows what that means, please let us know. But Out of Print is doing something very similar with this, that what they did with Light of the Jedi when that book came out by Charles Soule, which is they've partnered and they're putting together an exclusive collector's edition. And I actually did sign up for the email alerts for when this one's going to be available, because with Out of Print, we've talked about before, they do the t-shirts and they do the socks and that kind of thing. So this one actually does have, it's $150, and they actually do have it right there on Out of Print. And there's, I'm assuming that there's going to be some Out of Print kinds of goods to go with it too, whether it be like there were socks for the Light of the Jedi.
Sure.
So I'm not sure what they're going to have to go with this one to accompany it, but at any rate, I signed up for it. So yeah, I might just have to say, you know, take my money. So if you go to Out of Print, there's actually a place where you can say it says, click notify me when available and be the first to know. So I did sign up for that. And then the other thing about this is I did look up the artist that created this exclusive jacket, Magali Villeneuve. And I'm sorry if I pronounced her name very poorly, but she is a concept artist and she has a lot of beautiful, beautiful things. So she's done everything from Magic the Gathering. She's done Game of Thrones. She's done Lord of the Rings, G.I. Joe, Dungeons and Dragons. So she's actually got a lot of, you know, chops when it comes to doing a lot of these kinds of things. So it's beautiful.
Yeah, I'm looking through her website. Thank you for putting that link in our notes, by the way. Sure. And she has some absolutely gorgeous art there. Mm-hmm. A lot of fantasy realms and dragons and things like that is what dominates the page. But this portrait that she made of Thrawn in his uniform, like you said, with all the medals and the gold pauldrons and everything else, is just fantastic. You know, this makes me want, and I hope Del Rey or DK is listening, a visual guide to the Thrawn Ascendancy series.
Yes.
I would love to see all the different characters. I'd love to see them in their uniforms. I'd love to see all the ships. I'd love to see all the aliens, their homeworlds, everything. There is so much there that Timothy Zahn does a great job of describing, but nothing beats a great painting or a sketch or something. I would love mm-hmm. to see all this stuff brought to life in a visual guide somewhere.
Definitely. And I have a feeling that we might just be seeing her in Artist Alley at the next Star Wars Celebration as well. So
that'd be fantastic. Yeah. I'd love
Absolutely.
To see that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, we got one last bit in the news, and this time we're heading over to VR video games, and we have a new installment from the Star Wars Tales from the Galaxy's Edge series coming in part two. The ILM X-Lab announced that they have a new installment coming out that will be featuring Doc Ondor, who is the Ithorian treasure dealer and owner of Doc Ondor's Den of Antiquities in Batuu. Or I should say Black Spire Outpost on Batuu. And so if you aren't familiar with him, you can learn more about him in the Galaxy's Edge comic from Marvel. You can also find out a little bit more about him in the two books, the adult and young adult novels that have been out there that have surrounded Black Spire Outpost. One's called Black Spire Outpost by Delilah S. Dawson. And he's this, again, a Ithorian antiquities dealer. He's somewhat of a scoundrel in that he's not necessarily always on the up and up. He presents an appearance of a respectable businessman, but he kind of has some backroom dealings and some under the table type of stuff going on as well. Interesting character. And the story that they've got over on StarWars.com talking about this makes mention that he's been brought to life in the Galaxy's Edge theme park, and they've been very, very, very careful to preserve that character so that he's not something that is different than what you would encounter if you went and saw him in his shop at Galaxy's Edge. And I just really love that aspect of this project. I'm not privy, or I don't have access to an Oculus Quest device in order to play this. Hopefully someday they'll port it over to the PlayStation and I can check it out there. But this just seems really, really cool.
It really does. And I'm with you there. I don't have an Oculus or anything like that, but just some of the things that I've seen about it and some of the, you know, images and whatnot have just been absolutely fabulous. And you're right. I mean, that painstaking detail that they take in translating the exact animation to this one-to-one representation of the exact head that you would see in the park, I think is just, again, just a tribute to the attention to detail that the creative geniuses in all of Star Wars, all across all of the different things that they do, are just really trying to make it authentic for fans. No matter what you do, no matter whether you go to the parks, you pick up a book, a comic, play a game, whatever, and they're really doing a phenomenal job with it.
Yeah, very much so. And I'm looking forward to when this virtual reality stuff is a little bit more common, just like you have an Xbox platform, you know, a PlayStation platform. Back in the day, it used to be Nintendo and Sega, whatever. And they would typically get a lot of the same games simultaneously at the time. Mm-hmm. And so I'm looking forward to when VR is easier to make and common enough that they can be out on multiple platforms at one time. And so that more of us have an access to this. And because this just seems really, really cool, but I don't know that I'm going to buy the Oculus system just for this.
Right. Yes, I agree.
Is a pretty significant investment. But back in the day when they had Shadows of the Empire out pre-COVID is when, you know, you could last check it out. That was an outstanding virtual reality presentation of a Star Wars adventure. You know, it takes 15, 20 minutes to go through the whole thing, but it definitely left you wanting more at the end. So mm-hmm. There's definitely a market for this and I'd love to see more of it.
I agree. And I think I would agree with you as well on trying to get everything just more of a cross-platform kind of a thing and making it more accessible.
Definitely so. All right. Well, then, it's not been a big week for Star Wars news, but we covered it all, or at least the big stories. And that'll bring us to the end of this monumental episode, 250 of Podcast Stardust. We'd just like to thank you all for listening and joining us for our discussion of this week's Star Wars news. We'd like to also remind you that we are part of the Retro Zap Podcast Network and that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, Audible, wherever you listen to your podcasts, we should be there, and that includes the Retro Zap Podcast feed. And one more thing. It's been brought to my attention that Apple Podcasts typically only makes the last 100, 150 or so episodes of a podcast available. So, if you're new, we'd love it if you checked out some of the earlier episodes of the podcast, and merchesapp.com would be a great place to do that, and so would Spotify. They keep all the episodes available there. Just a couple more things before we go. We'd always appreciate a 5-star rating and a review over on Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to look us up over on social media and say hello. We'd love to hear from you and what you think about our most recent episode. With that having been said, Jay, if you could remind everybody where they can find us one more time.
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And if you'd like to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. And you can always check out our Pinterest boards and our YouTube channel, where you can catch all of our episodes, not just 100 of them, and our unboxing videos of some really great products. And you can also catch us for some great chatter over on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server. You can also catch all of the other RetroZap shows over there as well as other dedicated rooms to things like the High Republic and our running group, Star Wars Lore, and just everything that you can possibly think about with Star Wars is probably over there. And I think it is. And last but not least, you can always sport your Podcast Stardust swag if you go over to tpublic.com/user/podcaststardust, and you can pick up a t-shirt, a sweatshirt, coffee mug, a wall hanging, a pillow, whatever your little heart desires, and it's over there. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all of those great show logo designs.
All right. Once again, that'll do it for episode 250 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for your support, and thanks for listening to this episode, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.